Dear children, today we are going to study why. Why some liquid and solid shapes are different. For example, in example 1, we are taking the pairing between water molecules and glass molecules. As we know that water and molecules and glass molecules are making a different pair, so adhesive force will be acted between them. Now, this adhesive force between water molecules and glass molecules is greater than the cohesive force between water and water molecules. Let's example, I am taking a container in which I have poured water. So why it becomes that the water molecules which are near to the glass wall becomes such a shape as it takes concave shape? So why these water molecules rise to the upper part such that the shape of water molecules with glass surface becomes a concave surface? Because this is the proper reason that adhesive force between water and glass molecules is greater than the cohesive force between water and water molecules. यहाँ water and water molecules जो forces लगा रहे हैं वो इस side के water and glass molecules के adhesive forces के comparison में कम है. So ये water molecules नीचे ही रह जाते हैं because they feel surface tension, as well as due to surface tension or to decrease their potential energy, they feel a net downward force, as we have studied the molecular theory of surface tension. Hence, whenever water is poured on the glass, the water molecules cling with the glass molecules. Hence, water molecules cling means stick with the glass molecules and the glass surface is wetted. This is a practical point, but if we are studying the pairing between mercury and glass surface, so we will be taking mercury molecules and glass molecules. As we know that adhesive force between mercury molecules and glass molecules, this is adhesive force, is less than the cohesive force between mercury and mercury molecules. Hence, mercury and mercury molecules cling to each other. For example, now I am taking a glass tube in which we have filled mercury. Now this is the temporary shape, as we know that the density of mercury is 13.6 gram per centimeter cube, whereas the density of water was 1 gram per centimeter cube. Hence the density of mercury is 13.6 times, or we can say that specific gravity of mercury is 13.6 because it is 13.6 more denser than that of water. तो इस place पर ये जो walls के पास वाली place हैं, इस place के जो molecules हैं वो कोहेसिव फोर्स फील करते हैं टुवर्ड्स दीज मॉलिक्यूल्स एंड इस प्लेस के मॉलिक्यूल्स नेट कोहेसिव फोर्स फील करते हैं, बट ये जो मॉलिक्यूल है वो एडहेसिव फोर्स भी फील करता है ड्यू टू वॉल एंड बिकॉज कोहेसिव फोर्सेस आर ग्रेटर देयरफॉर ये जो मॉलिक्यूल्स हैं ये मॉलिक्यूल्स अपना नेट शेप कॉन्वेक्स बना लेते हैं because the cohesive force is more in this case, hence this surface becomes convex. This we will be studying in detail according to the parallelogram law of forces. Hence the mercury does not wet the glass surface and when we reverse pour out the mercury from a glass container, the side walls are always dry because mercury doesn't wet the glass. So keep two points in remembrance. First, water wets the glass and second, mercury does not wet the glass. Water makes concave surface with glass whereas mercury makes convex surface with the glass. Now next question arises, this is the conceptual question, why we can write on paper with the help of ink pen or why we can write on board with the help of chalk. These are two very important conceptual questions. We can write on the paper with the help of ink because the adhesive force between paper and ink, the adhesive force between paper and ink is greater than the cohesive force between ink and ink molecules. And for the second reason, it carries the same concept, the adhesive force between board and chalk is greater than the cohesive force between chalk and chalk molecules. So this is the proper concept which you should take in consideration. Next topic is shape of liquid meniscus in a glass tube. For example, if we pour some liquid in a glass tube, then it may take these cases or these shape. Meniscus means the very upper surface which is taking a particular shape. So suppose when we pour liquid in a glass tube, it may be flat, but this is the rare case. Second, it may take concave shape as we have seen in water and glass pair. And third, it may take a convex shape as we have seen in mercury and glass surface. Concave example is water and glass surface. Convex example is mercury and glass surface. And this is very very rare example which happens in the case of capillary tube. So first we are considering a container in which we are taking just the discussion of shape of liquid meniscus in a glass tube. So let's take, this is a glass container and for the left wall I am showing the macroscopic view. So this is the left wall, this is solid wall and this is liquid which we have poured in a container. For the sake of convenience, the whole container is not shown here, only the left wall to explain forces in proper way is shown. So let's take a molecule A, this is a molecule A which is on the water surface near the glass. Now we will see how many forces will act on this molecule. All the forces we will list. First force is the gravitational force, that is mg of liquid molecule A. But as this liquid molecule has negligible mass, hence we can neglect this weight of the liquid molecule. Now second is, this liquid molecule in this part will be surrounded by air molecules. So these air molecules will be acting the adhesive force on this liquid molecule A. Now I am saying the term adhesive forces because this is a liquid molecule and these are air molecules, and the force of attraction between molecules of two different substances is always called as an adhesive force. So adhesive force between liquid and air molecules is so negligible that again it can be neglected. So two forces are neglected due to their negligence. Now the third force is cohesive force applied by other liquid molecules in this sphere of influence, because suppose we are making its sphere of influence, so half of its sphere of influence is on the right side of the wall, out of which quarter of the sphere of influence is within liquid. So the liquid molecules which are present at a distance of molecular range will be applying a cohesive force on this liquid molecule A. So this is a cohesive force, whereas to the left side of liquid molecule A there is all over solid molecules. So these solid molecules will be applying the adhesive forces on molecule A. But this adhesive force will be just perpendicular to the wall surface. This will always be applicable. So this is the adhesive force between molecule A and the solid wall. So this is adhesive force on molecule A, and this was cohesive force on molecule A. Now as we can see, the strength is more for the adhesive force. So when we will draw the parallelogram to find the resultant of these two forces, we get that the resultant of these two vectors will be lying outside the liquid range. So this is the resultant of two forces. So this resultant is lying outside the liquid range. Now as we come in the middle of the tube, suppose again we are drawing a macroscopic view for water and glass sphere. As we come in the middle of the tube, these forces like cohesive force for suppose the middle molecule will be just the vertical to the free surface or free meniscus of the liquid, and this adhesive force will be negligible. So this adhesive force applied by the wall molecules or the glass container will be approximately zero for the middle molecules, and this force will be exactly perpendicular to the walls. Hence, to maintain these angles, this surface takes this shape such that these are the directions of different forces. And if the liquid surface is in equilibrium, by the condition of equilibrium, the net forces on the body in concern is equal to zero. So the resultant force acting on any molecule on the surface must be perpendicular to the surface. So as we have seen, this was the resultant force. So this resultant force will be making like radius and tangent pair. So this will be becoming such as these corner molecules will be upholding their positions such that the radius and the tangent becomes perpendicular to each other in the case of equilibrium, and hence the water meniscus becomes concave in the case of water and glass surface. Example of mercury and glass surface: when mercury is poured in a glass, again only the side wall is shown in the figure, not complete container. And suppose this is some of the mercury poured in this container. Let's assume a mercury molecule which is near to the wall. Now in the case of mercury, cohesive forces are stronger as compared to the adhesive forces. So over this mercury molecule A, one of the force will be the gravitational force, which is negligible due to its negligible mass. Second is the adhesive force by air molecules. Again, this will be negligible due to the small value of adhesive forces by air molecules on mercury molecule A. Third is the adhesive force by wall molecules or glass container molecules. So suppose we are considering this adhesive force as P, and second is the cohesive force by other mercury molecules. So because in this case cohesive forces are strong, so we will be drawing the longer arm for the cohesive forces. So let's assume this cohesive force is Q. Now to find the resultant, when we complete this parallelogram, the diagonal, common diagonal of this parallelogram goes inside the mercury liquid. So this is the resultant. Now as we are going to the middle of the liquid, then the magnitude of P goes on decreasing while the cohesive force Q becomes more and more vertical. So you may note down, as we go towards middle of mercury, then the magnitude of P goes on decreasing while the cohesive force Q becomes more and more vertical. Consequently, this resultant force R also becomes more and more vertical. So for these two forces, we can pass the word as more and more vertical. Hence, in the middle of the surface, almost P becomes zero and Q becomes almost vertical. So this is the near picture of mercury with the glass surface, in which at the middle of the mercury Q becomes exactly vertical and other forces are radial, as they are making a curve. Hence the resultant force R, when becomes exactly vertical, then this liquid molecule depresses itself, and hence the mercury near the solid wall is depressed and the surface becomes convex. So in either case, the resultant force in the middle is vertical, either in the case of water or in the case of mercury, and the surface there is horizontal. Now this topic we have already studied and watched the video also, pressure difference across two sides of a liquid surface, as we have already studied that a liquid surface may be flat. In this case, pressure difference will be zero. In second case, the liquid surface is concave. So if this is the solid container and the liquid surface is concave, then suppose we are taking two parts or two points A and B, then the pressure on the concave side is greater always than that on the convex side. So over here PA is greater than PB, hence PA minus PB will be greater than zero. And by derivations, it was derived that this pressure difference is numerically equal to 2T divided by R, where T is the surface tension of this liquid and R is the radius of curvature of the surface. This is also called as meniscus. Now suppose if we complete this sphere, imaginarily, if we are completing this sphere, then this sphere will somewhere have its center, and that radius is called as the radius of the curvature of the surface. So over here we are taking this R as radius of curvature of this surface. Now third case may be the liquid surface is convex. So suppose this is a container and this surface is convex, and over here the liquid will exist in equilibrium. This is the example of mercury and glass surface. This may be the example of water and glass surface, and this may be the example of a liquid in a capillary which completely wets the solid surface. For example, pure water and capillary where the angle of contact is 0 degree. Then over here, if we complete this sphere imaginarily, this will have certain a center imaginary. So this is called as radius of curvature. And again, let's taking two points A and B. Now B side is on the concave side, so pressure on B point is greater than pressure on A point. Therefore PB minus PA will be greater than zero. Hence excess pressure will be 2T divided by R. This is called as excess pressure, or the difference of pressure. So based on this theory, next topic will be excess pressure inside a liquid drop, an air bubble in a liquid, and a soap bubble. So we are doing next derivation is find the excess pressure inside a liquid drop. As we have already studied that a liquid drop is filled inside by the liquid, and outside a liquid drop there exists the surrounding medium air unless specified. So assume that the liquid drop is originally is of radius R, and hence outside when it will expand, its radius will increase by the amount del R. So because the internal side is the concave side, and just in the previous topic we have studied that pressure on the concave side is greater as that on the convex side. So suppose cut this liquid drop in two parts, then we can easily imagine that this side will be concave, and hence pressure inside the drop will be more as compared to the outside. So this is P plus del P. Hence the excess pressure del P inside the drop pushes a force or applies a force in the outward direction which balances the surface tension force. This force will balance the force due to surface tension, and hence the drop will be in equilibrium. Equilibrium means drop burst nahi hogi. So this force is the outward force. So let's, for the derivation, say we are taking inside pressure greater than the amount del P and outside pressure is less, which is P. So the excess pressure will be del P. Now, due to this force, the radius of the drop increases by the quantity del R, or by the small distance del R, where del R is so small. This is so small, such that the pressure inside the drops remain unchanged. So pressure will not change. Always, whenever force produces a displacement, the mechanical work is done. So this mechanical work done in this process is equal to W equal to force into displacement. Now this force is produced by the excess pressure. So this force is equal to excess pressure multiplied by area multiplied by the displacement. Now this excess pressure over here we have taken as del P into area of this original drop is 4 pi r square into this small displacement is del R. So this may be equation number 1 of our derivation. Now when the drop changes its radius or increases its radius, then its surface area is also increased. Hence, we can easily find the increase in surface area of the drop, which is del A. So this is equal to final area minus initial area. Now final area is 4 pi R plus del R square minus 4 pi R square. Now taking the identity of A plus B whole square, this is equal to A square plus B square plus 2AB using the suitable quantities minus 4 pi R square. So multiplying by distribution law 4 pi R square, this quantity is neglected as this is very very small. So we are directly going to 2R into del R. So this is plus 4 2's 8 pi R del R minus 4 pi R square. So these opposite components cancel, and hence we get del A equal to 8 pi R into del R. Now as we had taken the shortcut of surface energy as W equals to del A into T, that by the trick Watt, hence increase in surface energy is W equals to del A into T. So putting the value of del A as 8 pi R into del R into T, this will be equation number 3 for our derivation. Now we can equate equation 1 and 3 because this increased energy is at the cost of work done by the excess pressure. So this increased energy we are getting from equation number 3, and this excess pressure work done we have got from equation number 1. So when we are putting both equal, this is P into 4 pi, this was del P into 4 pi r square del r, and this is equal to 8 pi r del r into t. Now cutting the common pi pi, 4 2s r r del r del r, we get del p equal to 2t divided by r. So this is excess pressure inside a liquid drop, where t is the surface tension and r is the radius of liquid drop. Next we are going to do excess pressure inside an air bubble in a liquid. So assume the figure first. This is a container, a liquid is filled in, and this is an air bubble which is inside the liquid. Now again, the original radius of the air bubble is capital R, assuming it as capital R, and this is the concave side, means the inside of the bubble is the concave side. Hence over here the pressure will be more, that P plus del P, and outside the pressure will be P. Hence this excess pressure provides an outward force on the bubble to increase its size by a little distance del R. So suppose due to this difference of pressure, bubble increases its size by a very small displacement, which is equal to del R. Now this bubble has only one free surface, because only the internal surface is in contact with air. So proceeding the same way as in the case of liquid drop, we can prove the formula for excess pressure inside the air bubble. Then we get final formula as del P equal to 4T divided by R. This is for do it yourself. Okay, you should try this derivation by yourself. Again, where if the liquid bubble or the soap bubble or the air bubble will have two free surfaces, then this will be the formula. But in the present case, when air bubble is surrounding in a liquid, then excess pressure will hold the same formula as 2t upon r as in the previous case. So for this case we can draw the diagram. This is air bubble. So inside air, outside air. Let's assume this is a soap film. So this soap bubble or somewhat air bubble will have two free surfaces, because internal as well as external is in contact with air. Therefore, inside this type of bubble, the excess pressure will be twice to that of the drop. But the present case shown here will have the excess pressure formula same as it was in the case of drop. So whenever a bubble will be placed in a liquid, the expression for excess pressure will be same as that of a drop. So in next part of our series for mechanical properties of fluids, we will be doing some numericals and the formula for capillary rise, as well as all the concepts related to capillarity. Till then, enjoy your learning. Thank you.